The following program is a television outreach of Whole Life and Sandra Kennedy Ministries in Augusta, Georgia, and is sponsored in part by our friends and partners for life from around the world.
Call those things that be not as though they were, and watch dead things come to life again. Hello, this is Sandra Kennedy, pastor of Whole Life Ministries in Augusta, Georgia. I'm telling you, I hope you've already put it down on your calendar. We got a healing explosion coming up right here in Augusta, Georgia, this Friday night, July the 15th. They're coming from every nation. That's not really true. They come from every state. And they have been coming from about 20 nations. We are seeing so many people get healed. I teach you the Word of God. I tell you how to grab hold of it. And it's amazing what is happening in people's lives. I think the least number we've ever been healed is 60%, but we've had as many as 90%. Again, that's this Friday night, July the 15th. Today, this message that we're going to teach you, there are nuggets that you can learn from. Have you learned lessons from God's Word? Listen, this is about Noah. You're going to laugh. You're going to cry. You're going to love it. I promise you. Learn something from what has happened in the past and let you and I walk out our fullness upon the earth. I promise you, you go get some nuggets. We're so excited about what God is doing. You know, God's been so faithful to us, and the lessons that we've been going over in the Old Testament, and God's taken us all kind of directions through it. Always, it says over in Corinthians, that we learn that the lessons in the Old Testament are supposed to be teaching us things and truths for today. So what I'm going to teach you tonight, I entitled, Have We Learned Lessons from God's Word? Have we really learned what God is trying to say to us? And so I went back to something I did years ago, and I thought this is so appropriate for today and what God's trying to say to us. So let's go over to Matthew. Matthew chapter 24, and then we're going back over to the Old Testament, but let's go to Matthew 24, we'll pick up in verse 35. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will not pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. Now, this is the key that we're going to go back and read something about Noah. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And they did not understand until the flood came and took them all away. So will the coming of the Son of Man be. All right, now remembering that God's making a comparison here in the New Testament, and he's comparing it to something we should have learned from the Old Testament. So let's go to Genesis chapter 6. Matter of fact, it's Genesis 6, 7, and 8. Don't worry, I'm not going to teach all of them. But, I may. Genesis chapter 6. By the time you get to Genesis, this, of course, is where you come to the story of Noah and the ark, okay? So let's pick up, let's pick up in verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord, or found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Now, in order to understand that, you have to go back to verse 5. Because it says, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continuously. Now, again, we're making a comparison. The Bible says that the coming of the Lord will be as the days of Noah. So let's put it in perspective. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continuously. The Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. The Lord said, I will blot out man whom I've created from the face of the land, and from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky, for I am sorry that I've made them. And come back to the verse we read, but Noah found grace or favor in the eyes of the Lord. And then it goes on talking about
how God appeared to him and told him how to build the ark. And let's go to verse 18. But I will establish my covenant with you. The Lord is talking to Noah. I'm going to establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark. Told him how to build the ark. You and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. And every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every kind into the ark to keep them alive with you. And they shall be male and female. And of the birds after that kind, animal after that kind, it goes on and it says all of those kind of things that we are to do. And then it says down in chapter 7 that the Lord said to Noah, enter the ark, you and your household, for you alone have I seen to be righteous before me in this time. Now let me take a minute and pull all of this together. We're living in days, and you and I know already, there are wicked days. And we are already learning that Christianity is being attacked on all sides by anybody and everybody. We know that. All kind of crazy things are happening everywhere, not only here in America, but all over the world. And the Bible says people are looking for the return of the Lord. And the Bible says that it will be like the days of Noah when the Lord returns. So that means that we should learn something about what was going on during the time of Noah. And it said that, now get this, and this is a little scary to me because this is a number game again. Here we are with, you know, thousands or millions, we do not know. We know thousands of people upon the earth at that time. And yet here we end up with one man and his family, so to speak, who were considered righteous. Now, if you're born again, washed in the blood of the Lamb, we are righteous. We are called the righteous of God. We have been made righteous by his blood, so we are righteous. Now, if we were to put it in perspective, because there are billions upon the face of the earth today, and since Jesus has come and died so many years ago, 2,000 years ago, and came up out of the grave, praise God, there have been billions upon billions of people upon the earth. And so we're still talking about only the righteous. You take the ark. Remember, the flood came, and then the ark rose up above the flood. So the ark was a kind of rapture, we could call it. It was a kind of rapture that it rode above the problem, taken above the problem, taken out of the problem. And only the people in the ark were the righteous. Now, in this day and age, it's still going to be only the righteous that will survive and go on with the things of God. So that is of utmost importance that you know the Lord, because you can't be righteous outside of him. He makes you righteous. The blood of Jesus makes you righteous. You don't make yourself righteous. You are either righteous or you're not righteous. You're not more righteous or less righteous. You're just righteous. And Jesus makes you righteous. Now, knowing him in your heart. So if you don't know Jesus, let's just put it like it is. You are not righteous. And therefore, the wickedness of the time will absolutely suck you up in it. And the wickedness of the time will devour you. And you will miss the time with the Lord. And you will not be taken out from the things of this earth and what's happening on this earth. Because only the righteous will be taken out. Now, I did this years ago, and I looked back at it, and I thought, good grief, have we really learned any lessons? So I'm going to go back for some lessons here pertaining to the flood and what we could learn from it. I've got a bunch of them. First thing that we can learn is that you don't want to miss the boat. So what is the lesson that's associated with not missing the boat? Avoid procrastination. Look at we're talking about little lessons that we can learn. You don't want to miss the boat. You don't want to miss the boat. So that means you do not want to be people who procrastinate. Now, there are a lot of us who fall in that category. We're always going to do something. We're always going to do something right. We're always going to get our life together. We're always going to work this out. We're always going to come back to the Lord. We're always going to put everything in order. And we've been, for months now, I've been talking about getting your life in order. I've been talking about priorities, rearranging things. We've gone over it and over it again. God has been visiting us in significant ways. And in the center of all of it, it has been, you have a certain length of time. You better wake up and you better put things in order. So don't miss the boat. Quit procrastinating. Second thing you can learn is plan ahead. It wasn't raining when Noah built the ark. So what is the lesson from that? There is a necessity of preparation. We all should be preparing. Everybody's telling us in the days in which we're living, I've been telling you for a very long time, that you should always save and put aside and have food and water and things for any kind of emergency that might come your way. You should just always make those kinds of preparations. Number three, you have to remember that we are all in the same boat. Now, if we're going to get in the boat, we're righteous. The righteous people get in the boat. Now, what's the lesson of that? We have to learn how to cooperate with each other. And that's one lesson that I'm afraid that the church has never learned. We have not learned. Everybody wants to do their own thing, their own way. We have to learn to lay down our agenda. And we have to learn to get united. We have to learn to come together. We have to learn that we don't live on an island. We have to learn that there is power in unity. So that's why the devil tries to keep us always just totally going every kind of direction under the sun. And if the church was really wise and the church were really wanting to be powerful and learn spiritual truths, we would above all learn the lesson of unity, that we would come together and learn what we can agree on and get your eyes off of what we disagree on. We all agree that Jesus is the Son of the living God and that we know that the world needs him and the world's going to hell without him, and we should focus on that. We should forget about the color of the carpet, where the organ is. They don't have organs anymore. Where the organ is, or what color the ceiling is, or what you do this, or where you put the piano, whether you don't put the piano, or, you know, or stuff like that. That is of zero value. But we need to come together and agree this world's on its way to hell. You and I are the light in the darkness, and we need to shine so that people can come to Jesus and just get on. Another thing, I love this one. You should stay fit, because Noah was 600 years old when the Lord called him. And so you should stay fit, because the Lord might ask you to do something really big. And you need to get with the program. You don't want to have to get yourself ready for it. You need to be ready. So that is the value of trying to preserve and look after yourself and take care of yourself. Absolutely. Build those muscles up here, not down here. And you got to really go with it in the name of the Lord. Then you got the lesson is to keep your focus. And in order to keep your focus, that means don't listen to the critics. Don't pay any attention. Just get about the business of building the boat. In other words, do what God tells you to do. Don't even take time and waste your time nor energy arguing with those who don't know doodly squat. Quit arguing with those and just stay focused on what God has called you to do. You know, be like Nehemiah. I do not have time to come off this wall to mess with your foolishness. Hello, you know, if you want to argue, go argue with somebody else who's going to hell. Well, he didn't say it that way. I mean, to refocus that. Because I'm on my way to heaven and I'm following the Lord. And so quit trying to get me out of the plan of God. Y'all doing good. Y'all doing good. Then you have to have a noble expectation. Yes. I'm going to say that would be called build your future on higher ground. Amen. Because God, every time in the Bible, you will hear him say, come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. He never says, could you get a little lower, please? Could you get a little lower? No, God is always telling us to rise above situations and circumstances. Now, we are living in these days, and these are lessons just to learn from looking at Noah and what he learned from just that ark, and things that you and I could learn. And I promise you, you don't want to be trying to learn them later. You want to catch on now. And you also need to understand that you need to cherish your friends because you had to travel in pairs. Right. Are you with me? So cherish your loved one. Honor your loved one, even if they were born in Georgia. Honor your loved one. And those who are watching don't know what I'm talking about, but it's okay. It's all right. Hallelujah. Georgia girls, hallelujah. So anyway, but you want to take care of your friends. You want to take care of your family. You remember years ago, the Lord said, take care. I'll never forget it. Y'all know I've told you many times. He said, take care of those who take care of you. And I'm going to say it to you again. Can you imagine if the church would just do that? Take care of, how simple. Take care of those who take care of you. That will be employees, take care of your employer. That would be husbands, take care of your wife. Wife, take care of your husband. Children, take care of your parents. Parents, take care of your children. And everybody, take care of your pastor. So. And then another thing you have to remember is speed is not always an advantage. Because the snails got on the boat just as well as the hyenas or whoever it was that goes real fast. Hallelujah. Cheetahs, whatever they are. Right. And so you don't have to get in too big of a hurry. You just have to get on the boat and go at your pace and get on the boat. Another thing, remember the ark was built by amateurs. You do not need professionals. Just do it. Look at your neighbor and say, just do it. You remember the ark was built by amateurs, the Titanic was built by professionals. Hallelujah. We will move right on. Glory to God. So, and the other thing is, there is value in free time. The ark just floated. Sometimes we just need to learn to float. I mean, you just need to just lay back and just float and coast. You know, you don't always have to be making a splash. Y'all will get that later. So just learn to float. Then you need to, no matter how severe the storm is, if you're in His will, there's going to be a rainbow. There'll always be a rainbow. There'll always be a rainbow. So you remember the faithfulness of God. And also, you have to remember that you need to pay attention to what God's trying to say by the voice you hear. God still communicates with His people, and so the voice you hear could be God talking to you, and He could be telling you to do something you've never thought of in all of your days. Matter of fact, He could be telling you to do something nobody's ever thought of, because God is filled with God ideas. He is always on our side. He's always telling us to do things, but we just talk too much. We need to get quiet and listen to the voice of the Lord. He still, I believe with all my heart, in these days that we're living in, I believe with all my heart that God's going to drop inside of us God ideas. Yes. For those who want to hear them, that will make us the head and not the tail, that will make us more than conquerors in this life, that will show us how to overcome, because God looks after His own. Yes. But you've got to be expecting God to give you a word. You got to be expecting God to speak to you. Now, it doesn't take a test to believe God's word. In other words, you know, when you really think about it, the ark was a totally untested boat. Amen. Totally. Well, I just need to test this a little bit. What we call it is, I'm going to put out several fleeces, and you go get fleeced, my friend. Let me remind you that putting fleeces out is an Old Testament thing that people did. It is not a New Testament thing. In the Old Testament, you did not have the Spirit of the Lord living inside of you. And so therefore, fleeces were acceptable. But in the New Testament, you have the Spirit of God living inside of you, and the Spirit of God is your leader, is your counselor, is your guide. The Spirit Himself will direct you, so you don't have to put out a fleece. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I grew up and we put out fleeces all the time. Now, how many people have ever put out a fleece? If you lie, you fry. Put out a fleece. Put out something. Well, God, if you'll show me this, then I know that's you. Some of y'all act like you don't even know what a fleece is. What kind of crowd am I with? Put out something where you say, okay, Lord, if this is you, let it rain 4 inches on this side of the road and 1 inch on this side of the road. And then it rains 4 inches on this side, and then you say, we need to try it one more time. And Lord, this time, let it rain 6 inches over here and 1 inch over here. And so it happens. And you say, oh, the Lord has spoken to me. No, the Lord lives inside of you now. And the Bible says that peace is your guide, and the Lord guides you from the inside. We are not even to be led by prophets. That always upsets people. The prophets are to confirm what God has already spoken, but they are not to lead us as they did in the Old Testament, because the Spirit of the Lord is inside of us. Now let me ask, how many of y'all ever put out fleeces? Every little hand in here ought to go up. God forgive them, forgive me, forgive all of us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're now going to let the Spirit of the Lord lead us. Amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, it's good to be forgiven.
Hallelujah.
Say, it's good to tell the truth. Amen. Now, another thing is, be good and kind to animals. You may have to live with them a long time. You know, there are animals on that boat. More animals than people. And so you need to learn to be kind to animals. God not only cares about you, God cares about animals also. And I don't care who said animals aren't going to be in heaven. Mine are. Animals are going to be in heaven. I know they are. Because my animals think they're people. Hallelujah. And I'm not about to tell them they're an animal. Now, I've got a couple of animals that I've had through the years. I'm not real sure where they're going to end up. Don't y'all? Anybody got any like that? Hallelujah. And there's a couple that suits me fine if they don't show up. Hallelujah. But I know that God cares about what I care about. He cares about what you care about. God is a loving, kind, wonderful God. And if it takes my little animal up there to help me out, my little animal will be up there. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and say, she's telling it straight. Hallelujah. All right. Now I want to remind you that righteous living also has its benefits. Even if others think that you are a nut, living right in God's eyes still go to and fro. They still are looking. He's still hunting somebody who's living righteously. And so no matter what anybody else says, you live uprightly in the presence of God. Seek the things of God. Be led by the Word of God, because the Bible says, as it was in the days of Noah, when the world was so wicked and so and such a terrible state, when the world was, everything was going every kind of way that it could possibly go. When is Jesus coming back? Everybody says, when's Jesus coming back? Jesus is coming back as when the world is as the days of Noah, and that wickedness was everywhere, and as the days of Lot. Then he looked upon the earth, and all kind of sin and all kind of stuff was happening, and abominations was taking place. And if we ever lived in a world where that is happening, it is happening to us today. Yes. We should better keep your eye on the eastern sky. I'm telling you, the Lord says those who are looking for him will be the ones who will see him coming. And I believe with all of my heart that God is doing everything in his power to set us up for the return of the Lord and to get our lives in order. And whether anybody else wants to do it, whether anybody else wants to, and let me just throw this out while I'm throwing it, you know, you need to know Jesus as your healer, because in the days ahead, I don't know what's happening to the health care around us or what's going on, but you need to know who Jesus is. You know that he can multiply food. You need to know him for every area of your life. If no one else wants to learn, you learn. And you learn to trust God, and you know that, yes, God can be trusted in any and every situation, and you begin to make him Lord over every area of your life. If need be, we'll go fishing and find us a corn in the fish's mouth. Hallelujah. Because God will look after his own. He promises that. He promises that he'll take care of the righteous. So no matter which way the banks go, no matter what happens to the stock market, no matter what happens to this, or no matter what happens to that, God is on our side. God's going to be there for us. Learn lessons from the ark. Learn lessons from history. And we talked about it the other day, over and over again. Obedience, being obedient to God, walking in obedient to God, and believing his word and trusting his word, trusting God, being obedient to the word of God from Genesis to Revelation was the key to walking uprightly with God. Blessings come with obedience. Curses come with disobedience. And if you are upright with God, God will always turn your life around. He will always work on your behalf. He will always see that you are the head and not the tail. He will always help you no matter what's going on. And no matter what the world is doing, you and I are not a part of this world system. We belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. He's on the throne. He knows you by name. He is not mad with you. And He is Lord above all gods, because there is no God but Jehovah. And He is Lord in Jesus' name.
Are you positioned for victory? In the teaching, Have You Positioned Yourself?, Sandra gives keys to tell you how to position yourself for healing, abundant living, prosperity, and to fulfill God's plan for your life. Like it or not, there is a war between heaven and hell, and earth is caught in the middle. The 3-CD series, Turning Defeat into Victory, shows how, without spiritual insight, there are no victories. Learn to recognize the enemy, the battle, and how God will help you turn defeat into victory. It's been said of the book, the spirit of Elijah is in the land. It is far more than a history of Elijah. The applications are for our generation in life's situations. Order the Position for Victory package today and begin to apply these spiritual nuggets and biblical truths in your life, because your position is critical to your victory.
I told you you'd learn some nuggets about how to walk in victory, how to be who God has called you to be. Learn lessons from God's Word. Oh, man, this is exciting. Again, let me remind you, it's this Friday night, July the 15th, right here in Augusta, Georgia, 7 o'clock, Friday night, Healing Explosion. They really are coming from everywhere. Why don't you plan to come and put your faith out there, and let me teach you how to receive what God has already given you. You will love it. Now, the products, we give you products that will help you change your life. For instance, have you positioned yourself? Have you positioned yourself for healing? Have you positioned yourself for prosperity? Have you positioned yourself for deliverance? Have you positioned yourself to be what God has called you to be? Turning defeat into victory. Don't you ever let the devil whip up on you, because he's a liar and he's a loser, and God will help you turn every single defeat into a victory in your life. I promise you. And then the spirit of Elijah's in the land. I said I did this many years ago, but it is now that great time that God is moving. There are 27 chapters in here. And I want you to know that many people are using this in their Bible studies and in their churches or wherever, to help them get a group together and learn about the life of Elijah. Because so as it was when Elijah was here, I promise you, things are still happening. Where's the God of Elijah? He's still on the throne, and he's still moving in might and in power. Facebook, thank you for keeping up with us. Watch us on YouTube. Why don't you go to our website, sandrakennedy.org. You can order anything there. There are thousands of products. That's the truth. And you can watch us live on Sunday mornings. You can go archive our messages. You can, I think, put them down on your MP3 player. Partner with us. We would love it. $20 a month. We give you all kind of little gifts. We write you every month. We try to keep you abreast of what's going on. God is a wonderful God. He's not mad with you. He loves you. Walk in victory, my friend. He's on your side.